I'm here with my guest poet, Tom Laughlin. My name is Doug Holder, poet to poet, writer to writer. And actually, we're almost going to be having our 20th year celebration in 2003 will mark 20 years of me interviewing hundreds of poets and writers. It's been a great pleasure, and I'm glad that I have Tom Laughlin here, who has a new book out, the Rest of the Way, and he is a professor at Middlesex Community College, where he teaches creative writing, among other things, and he was just made the coordinator of the creative writing department there. He started the Vortex, which was a literary magazine at college, and he was also a reader for Plowshares for 10 years. So he's been around the block, and he's a very fine poet, and I'm glad to have him here. Thank you, Tom.
Great to be here, Doug. Thanks.
Tom, you studied at UMass Boston with folks like Lloyd Schwartz, Martha Collins, and others.
Mm-hmm.
How did this affect your craft?
I think they were great role models. They introduced me to all different poets, and the whole workshopping and getting feedback from a full class on your work, putting your stuff out there, and being challenged in that way, and reading closely others' work, and being required to really do that diligence and think about the different styles and genre and different mediums and ways that people were writing. Got me thinking about pushing my own limits in different ways, and just introducing me to different poets who I have, you know, enjoyed and I feel have influenced me over time. Yeah.
Now, this is your first collection published?
It is, yeah.
What took you so long?
Yeah, that's a good question. I was a student back in the 1980s and had some poems published and envisioned having a book by the time I was, say, 35 or something. But got involved teaching at community college, very intensive. Family life sort of came in the way, and priorities were different. And so this has finally come around to a time where I submitted some contests, and there was a contest for chapbooks and through Finishing Line Press, and I submitted, and I didn't win the $1,000 prize, but they wanted to publish the book.
You won the $1,000 prize?
No, I didn't, unfortunately, but it was, but they got back to me and wanted to publish this, and so it's kind of a greatest hits over many years. The first poem, Rest of the Way, was published in the 1980s, and is another, all the way up to a poem that was published by you in your Lyrical Somerville column just this past June. So it's sort of many years, greatest hits sort of for me.
Now, reading a book, you know, I came across a poem of about jazz, and I'm a lover of jazz. I listen to jazz every night. And I read your poem, Jazz, the conceit of a boy and girl in a drifting wooden raft, the format, the back and forth, and the, you know, wild gyrations between them is sort of like a jazz jam session. Can you tell me about this?
Yeah, I love jazz and listen to Eric in the Evening, who Boston WGBH programmed for many, many years, and have a cousin that's a jazz musician, and just love the interplay between musicians when there's sort of a central riff and the soloist, the guitarist, takes off with a solo and takes those notes in some new ways for themselves, and the other musicians sit back, support that, and sort of look on with awe as that soloist takes that music into a different direction. And then it, you know, switches over to the keyboardist, who takes off with their own solo. And it's that sort of playful, competitive nature that I just love, that makes a wonderful, you know, new experience in that improvisational jazz experience. And I had wanted for years to write a poem that would somehow capture that. and it was sort of rattling around, and I was driving and listening to Eric in the Evening one night, actually on Route 1 North, and suddenly came up with the first few lines of this and this idea, and I scrambled, pulled off the road to a gas station, couldn't find any paper, ran into the gas station and said, "Do you have any paper? I got to get things done." And the person said, "What are you talking? No, I don't have paper." And I said, "Anything to write on." And he said, "I have these old gas slips, these old-fashioned gas slips." And so I grabbed those, and I have the beginning of this poem written on that, those gas slips. And to me, that sort of playful competition of them diving and swimming, and there's a rope swing in that, that's sort of all about this competing and playful laughter and fun, that I think, for me, I was trying to capture that competitive.
Well, I think you did.
Playing. Thank you.
I think you did, Tom. Yeah. Perhaps you read that poem later.
Sure, sure. I'd be happy to.
Don't you hate when the paper doesn't... There we go. I see your poems as sort of merging with nature, and I remember, you know, I'm not a big nature poet. I remember feeling once merging with a tree when I had a nice dose of hashish. Do you have an immediate affinity? Did you have an immediate affinity for nature? Or was this something you learned to appreciate?
No, I grew up, my mother was a big lover of nature, and she was a poet, and wrote, published in some local newspapers up in the North Shore. But I grew up in West.
When newspapers had local poetry. Yeah,
like a weekly newspaper, kind of like the Somerville
There's
Times.
There's really nothing like that.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. So I grew up with woods right behind my house in west of Boston, in the suburbs and then north. And so we spent a lot of time playing in the woods and running around, you know, causing mischief in the woods. My mother loved birds and loved nature and would, you know, teach us things too. So, yeah, and there's a poem you may have thought of, The Dendrophile, which is a poem in my book called Dendrophile, which means lover of trees, and really one that I was thinking about where that all came from, and why I would tell people that I'm a tree hugger. I hike regularly, daily, in the woods, and so that poem came out of that, and thinking back to my childhood and some of those early childhood experiences.
Now, in the poem, Father's Lesson, it's sort of a list poem where your father gives you some homespun, very practical advice about living your life. Tell us about your father and the yin and yang of your relationship.
Yeah, I think that poem is one that certainly is one written with the kind of distance that I have as an adult. And thinking about both that, the good and bad. My father was a violent alcoholic, but he also had good qualities and was funny. He was he coached us in sports, and he was someone who was the life of the party. People really enjoyed, and he connected with people. But so that poem, to me, trying to capture both the good and the bad, some of those lessons that I've learned that are positive, but other ones that not so, that sort of continue to affect me. Yeah.
Right, you always remember that. Mm. So many, I spoke to so many people who had experiences with alcoholic family members. It's an epidemic. Mm. Oops. Okay.
And it's Veterans Week, this week when we're recording anyway, on Friday, and he was a veteran of World War II, and horrors like your father.
And he was, my father was a functioning alcoholic, you know, too. Charming.
Yep.
But a nice guy, but he wasn't a violent alcoholic. Yep. You're an English professor, as we talked about, at Middlesex Community College. And you've taught for a number of years. And if you had to list the three most important elements of a poem, what might that be? Just, I got it down to three, an arbitrary number.
Image, sound, and emotion.
You interesting. Can you elaborate a bit on that?
Well, certainly images that have to paint pictures for people, interesting images somehow that are fresh and that can grab someone. I think the sound in terms of alliteration and rhyme and rhythm is very important, musical qualities of poetry. And I think that those images and also the music are part of that, ways that we pull and reach for someone's emotions and emotional experiences, human experiences. So somehow the qualities that come through in terms of the emotions that the reader feels in experiences in that sitting of reading a poem, you know, would be important, central to me, I guess.
I always ask my guests, why should we read your book?
I think that all poetry can get us to see some things in different ways, get us to experience some different emotions and remember different emotions we've had, can draw memories and emotions from us, help us to process things that we've experienced, sometimes challenging or positive things, love experiences or tragedy, you know. And I hope that my book is, and my poems are ones that take people on journeys, emotionally and spiritually. I have a number of poems that are sort of journey poems that take you somewhere, and in the end there's sort of a, hopefully some sense of resolution and some sense of connection and peace of some kind, maybe.
Yeah. We have a lot of time, so you have a lot of time to read from your for your chapbook. But just tell us, where are you appearing? Coming up readings with your book.
Yeah, I'm reading next week at the Untitled Open Mic series in Lowell. Really active, wonderful place there. It's now at the Coffee and Cotton Cafe, and great atmosphere, featured reader and open mic there. I'm reading at Berkshire Community College out in Western Mass. I'm reading in Brockton in December, I think it's 17th. They have a series there out of the library. I'm reading at Middlesex Community College, my own school. My colleagues twisted my arm and want me to read where I have the chapbook coming out. So I'll be reading there on December 1st. Hasn't been scheduled, but Gloucester is coming up in another couple months, and reading in April in Concord through the New England Poetry Club.
The old Mets. Yeah.
Yeah, the old
you
Mets.
You are yeah. A member of the New England Poetry.
I am, yeah.
In good standing, right? Yeah.
Keeping up with my dues.
And your website is?
Yes, it's tomlaughlinpoet.com. And it has, I'll keep that up to date with my events. It also has links to poems, online poems, journals, magazines that are online. It lists my other work, but the online poems are linkable, you know, so you can read things that are not in the chapbook, newer poems and different ones over the years.
Great. So why don't you start reading from your chapbook?
Well, you mentioned my father, and I mentioned it is Veterans Day, so maybe in that sort of father's lessons I could read if you want, but
sure.
also the flamethrower.
Whatever, we have plenty of time.
So flamethrower is one because it's Veterans Day. I was thinking that might be appropriate, and we are in a time where we're seeing a lot in Ukraine that's reminding us of all the horrors of war and the ways that affects people and the generations of people that are affected by war. And Give background, in World War II, the M1 Garand was the rifle that was standard for the infantry in the U.S. military, U.S. Army. And the guns were made with shells that kicked off to the right, and left-handed soldiers holding that, it would sort of go in front of their face or maybe hit them in the face, and left-handed soldiers were often in a company would be trained to use a flamethrower, which is a horrible instrument, a horrible weapon that shoots a flame 45 yards and burns everything in sight. So this poem is called Flamethrower. A lefty, the guns weren't made for him, so he became a flamethrower, flushing out foxholes that couldn't be cleared. Children on fire still ripped through his dreams, forcing him down to the kitchen chair at 3 a.m. for a cigarette, highball, and late movie. I knew only hatred then, standing below that bald leather head, slapped in the face by the crooked fingers of his open hands. Dead bodies, malaria, teeth knocked in, words shouted into arguments too often to sting when intended, burn years later for a flamethrower's son. Thinking about all the veterans, your father and others.
So, yeah.
Well, you mentioned the trees in my love, and we mentioned the dendrophile, so maybe I can read that. I often joke that I'm a tree hugger,
So
that came out of me thinking about where all that came from and thinking back to an early
lesson. Reading in the Times today about this, they call it worldwide wood, and that there's these, they're sort of connected through fungi and all that.
Yeah.
And there's this strong connection.
They've learned there's like huge forests that are all connected as one big unit.
So they're very cooperative.
Yeah. Very much so, yeah.
Unlike the Republicans and Democrats, right? Okay.
So dendrophile, which means lover of trees. I'm having trouble with where's the camera, but anyway, I'll read to you.
Look at me look at the camera when you're reading, obviously.
Yeah. Dendrophile. They were our jungle gyms, our hanging bars, our hobby horses, our August cooling tents, our winter snow shakers, our climbing walls, our mountaintops, our citadels. They surrounded us as we ran, chasing each other, past their sappy bark, over pine needle thickened paths, the forest floor squishy with mulch, and the fibrous reaching roots of these silent sentinels standing watch over our boyhood selves as we grabbed for sticks at our feet. Broken branches weakened by boring insects, chiseled by birds bashing their hungry heads and cracked loose by the weight of winter. Swinging and slamming these against trunks, snapping pieces that spun in the air, flying past ecstatic eyes and nearly clipping our crew-cutted heads. And whose six-year-old challenge was it that day which set us attempting to climb pole-thin pines with their pencil-pointed stubs of branches long choked off by the thick canopy of green high above? Grabbing scratchy trunks, we stepped carefully, slowly, easing our weight onto one bone-dry stub, then another, the height competition continuing until a brittle crack to suddenly drop us tumbling to pine-needled floor. Then, unthinking, my sights on bragging rights, I reached up one stubbled trunk, hugging too closely its scratchy bark as I climbed, until the crack, the sudden drop, the unseen sharpened stub slicing as I pole-slid toward forest floor, a thin red line from my belly to chest. Afterwards, the stitches, the bandages, the long torso scar were show-and-tell exhibits until puberty and chest hair and decades erased any visible sign of that first woodland infection when sap began running through my veins.
Nice, nice. It's like the sap running through my land. Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah. Well, continue.
Sure. Maybe.
By the way, you once you have one book, you know, it's sort of infectious. You're gonna have others. Are you?
I'm not working on one right just yet, but you know, I do have lots of poems. This was sort of a greatest hits. So I am continuing, and I'll hope to have another one sooner than 35 years. So maybe I'll read a short love poem. James Wright is a favorite poet of mine, and I actually have a response poem of his in here. Maybe I could read that too. But he often had these long, delicious long titles, and this is a poem with a short poem with a very long title. And it is called "Finally Beyond the Pine Tree Back Roads of My Morning Commute, I Think of You Early This September Morning." The bright sun kisses the cornfields that I pass, grown tall and stretched near to bursting, with plump kernels of sweetness within, golden gems that sparkle and spill out over the tops, yellow happiness dancing like fireworks against a green, stalked sky. Because of you, I too feel these golden gems, this yellow happiness, this full heart bursting into dance.
Nice. Was that line yellow?
This yellow happiness.
Yellow happiness.
You know, there is, I mentioned the James Wright, your Ibbotson Street first published my James Wright response poem, and I do have some response poems in here. Maybe I could read that.
All right.
Yeah. His poem maybe is short, and maybe I could read that first.
Well, we have
for
time,
people.
Sure.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
And then both of them are pretty short, but his poem and his, again, long title, famous poem by the poet James Wright, "Lying in a Hammock at William Duffy's Farm in Pine Island, Minnesota. Over my head, I see the bronze butterfly asleep on the black trunk, blowing like a leaf in green shadow. Down the ravine, behind the empty house, the cowbells follow one another into the distances of the afternoon. To my right, in a field of sunlight between two pines, the droppings of last year's horses blaze up into golden stones. I lean back as the evening darkens and comes on. A chicken hawk floats over, looking for home. I have wasted my life."
I know his son, Franz. Franz Wright, he was at the Newton Library series, read. And every time he would read, he would throw the poem to the floor. You know, he said, "I don't know. You probably don't like this poem or something." Yeah.
So my poem is a kind of response poem to that, and imagining returning many years later. So my poem is called James Wright's Hammock, originally published in Ibbotson Street several years ago. James Wright's Hammock. Empty, it rocks slightly in the imperceptible midsummer breeze. The once white rope, bronzed by sun and rain, frayed. Midday rays slowly scorch the tall grass gone to seed. A pair of silent scrub pines remeasuring seven gray field stones between them. Fence post remnants slide into the ravine. From a dusty corner nest in the Duffy's abandoned farm, a swallow swoops its sickle wings, snatches a butterfly in flight, orange disappearing as quickly as it arrived. This is where I wake.
Nice. Nice. Well, I think you have time for
another one. Maybe I'll finish with The Rest of the Way, which is
okay.
A poem that came out of my experiences at UMass Boston many years ago that you mentioned, and I used to run the peninsula there.
I used to walk that. And running and walking is very meditative.
Absolutely.
It's very good for poetry.
And this poem sort of came out of that, and I imagined, I was young at the time, but imagine someone about my age or so, or our age, who had grown up in that area, sort of walking someone through, showing them
mm-hmm.
this area. So this is the rest of the way. Start here, just beyond the chain fence on the back street. It turns to footpath ahead, then left along the water. There's wild grass and seagulls, and the path breaks down into dirt around a boarded up pump house. Look at the islands out of ways, and two connecting, and bridge connecting two with the mainland. The dock by that white house there has boats sometimes, visitors. Breathe in seaweed, even dead fish smells, but don't stop. Round that corner, the city large across the bay, above the beach where old men swim naked every day, even through winter. The steps of stone are wide but low. They curve too like a rising tunnel, pulling you to streets and long needled spruce that reach for the brush of a hand passing. Down the slope, past the field that fills with pheasants in spring, go right and you'll recognize the rest of the way.
Well, Tom, I want to thank you for joining us on Poet to Poet, Writer to Writer, and I wish you the best of luck with your new book and your first book, and hope there'll be many more to come. Any final note you want to make?
Just thank you so much for having me. It's always wonderful and a great conversation. So thank you so much.
Thanks.